Focal Point, lift your voice and begin to praise God here. Oh, we honor you, yeah. Come on, let's worship him together. Sing just one word. You calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word. The darkness has to retreat, oh yeah, yeah. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Thank you, Lord. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. Sing it out. There's nothing that I God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Hey. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Yeah. Hey. Just one touch, you heal what's broken inside me. Oh, we feel you, God. Just one word, and you revive every tree. Oh, just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. Yes, Lord, just one touch. Come on. My eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. Sing it. There's nothing that I can't do. There's not a mountain that he can move. Oh, praise the name. Oh, there's nothing that I God can't do. There's not a prison wall he can't break through. Hey. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that I God can't do.
Yeah.
Oh, there's nothing. Come on, church, lift this up together. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, sing it out.
For greater things, there's no power like the power of Jesus.
Come on, declare it over your life.
Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like his power. There's nothing that our God can do.
There's not a mountain that he can move.
Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do. There's nothing that our God can do. There's not a prison wall he can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can do.
Come on, lift up a shout of praise. Come on, one more time, give him a shout of praise today, church.
Amen, amen. Lord, there is nothing you can't do, Lord. We love you, we worship you, Lord. We love you, Lord.
Who am I that the highest King would welcome me? I was lost, but he brought me in. Oh, his love for me. Oh, his love for me. Who the sun sets free. Oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Protecting us, covering us, with us in front of us, behind us, and beside us, always, always, Lord, always, Jesus.
I am chosen, not forsaken. at, would you just lift your hands? Let your soul just begin to talk to God right now. Oh, we need you, Jesus. We honor you. We honor you, yeah. Let your worship pour to him. Let your trust outpour to him. Hallelujah. Father, as we just continue to worship, we just thank you for your closeness to us. And we thank you, God, that you're so much bigger and so much stronger than what we can even see or ask for or imagine. God, we honor you. We cling to you today. You know, as we go into this next song, I want to thank all the people that have been praying for me, for my family, for my wife and really fighting for her in prayer and for the baby in her belly, just really believing for a miracle. And, you know, we can feel your prayers as we're praying. And I just wanted, as we sing this song, I know that you guys are going through things too. And I know that everyone may not know what you're facing, but my battle is not the only battle that's being waged here today. And so I want to sing this song for everyone who's in a battle and everyone who needs a breakthrough. And there's just power when we come together and we declare that our God is the one who's in control of the battle. And our God is the one who has command of heaven's armies. Amen. So as we sing this song, God, we just come up in arms with you. God, we declare that we are yours and that our battle is your battle and our fight is your fight. And we trust you, God. We sing this song to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, let's sing this together to him. 'Cause the weapon may be formed, but it won't prosper. And when the darkness falls, it won't prevail. 'Cause the God I serve knows only how to triumph. And my God will never fail. Oh, sing it. Sing, my God will never fail. Come on, church. And I'm gonna see a victory, hey! I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. Sing it by faith. I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, tell them, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. This power in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh, I know that every war he wages, he will win. And I'm not backing down from any giant. 'Cause I know how this story. Oh, I know, I know, I know. Yes, I know how this story. See a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you. Oh, I know I see, I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, for the battle belongs to you. Oh, I'm gonna see, I'm gonna see a victory, I'm gonna see a victory, lift it up. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah, I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. Yeah. Oh, lift up your faith to him. What the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Just lift it up. You turn it for good. Oh, we trust in you and see. You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good. Yes, he does. You turn. Come on, can you believe it by faith today? You take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.
Oh, yes, he does.
You turn it for good.
Oh, you take.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it for good.
Oh, we feel it, God.
You turn it for good.
Oh, you take, yeah.
You take what the enemy meant for evil, and you turn it.
See a victory, for the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory.
I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Sing it again.
Sing. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle. For the battle belongs to you.
Now listen right here.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Lift it up.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
Lift it up.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles.
Oh, we lift you up.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
Come on, lift your faith. This is how.
This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
One more time.
Sing. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles. This is how.
Hey, hey.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by it. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh yeah.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh, tell him.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh, it may look.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded. We feel you, God.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded.
You feel him here today.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you.
Oh yeah.
It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you, yeah. It may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm.
And lift your hands and sing.
That I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to.
Come on, right there, lift your hands and declare it.
I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to.
One more time, over your whole life, over your family.
I'm gonna see a victory.
Come on, sing that out, everybody.
I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Real quick, if you were to look in the book of Numbers, there's a story about how the Israelites, they're just crossing over, and they're on their way onto the promised land. And all of a sudden, they are immediately in a battle. Who knows that after a blessing, sometimes there comes a battle right after. And there came a battle, And the only way that they were able to win the battle, and it was such a weird thing, but it was such a God thing, was the position of Moses. He had to have his arms raised the entire time. In the moment that his arms began to come down, the army started losing. So right now, we have just a few more minutes for worship. I want us just to go back into that for a second. I want all of us to lift our hands up. Some of us, like Josh said, we might be facing some battles right now that we need to see a victory. We might need to let out that shout to let the Jericho walls fall down. I don't know what it is for you. I know the battles that are going on in my own life, so I know at least for me, I'm going to raise my hands and I'm not going to let them fall down during this time. And so as we are coming out of this pandemic, as we're coming out of the battles that we are in right now, let us keep our posture of worship, everyone. And so let's just go right back into that song, I'm going to see a victory, because it's so true, it is so prophetic, and we need to hear that in our lives right now. So you guys can go ahead and take it away.
I'm going to see a victory. I'm going to see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord. I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs.
Oh yes it does.
I'm gonna see a victory. I'm gonna see a victory. For the battle belongs to you, Lord.
Shout unto the Lord. Shout unto the Lord right now. Come on, tell those Jericho walls to fall down in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Woo! It is good to be in the house of the Lord right now. We got a bunch of worshipers in here. Woo! Amen. Amen. Well, everyone, happy Father's Day. Happy Father's Day. All my fathers, if you could do me a favor, just raise your hand for me real quick so we could just signify. We got some dads in here and just honor you for all the things that you do for your kids. I know for dads, sometimes it may not seem like you get all the attention. You might not seem like you get all the glory, but you do so much just behind the scenes and on the scenes. So we just want to take this time just to thank you. Amen. Amen. Everybody, you could be seated during this time.
Lord, today. Come on, for those of you watching online, who's glad that we have the technology to be able to watch it from home? Amen. This is wonderful. I have a couple of announcements for you today. Focal Point, guys, we know that there has been so much going on. These are unprecedented times. I feel like we've said that word so many times in this last several months. But our staff, our team, and our elders, we want to be here for you. We want to make ourselves available to each and every one of you. Whether you feel like maybe your life was shaken through the pandemic, maybe your family has been going through some extra struggles, or maybe you're simply frustrated, angry by the social injustice, the racial injustice, and the unrest in our nation, we're making ourselves available to you just to be a listening ear, to be able to minister to you. So to be able to take advantage of that, you can simply go online, focus focalpointchurch.com. We have a button there that says Request Ministry. There's a very short form. It's like two questions, just so we can kind of get a feel for what you need, and then we can put the right person with you to contact you very soon after that. So if you'd like that, please take advantage of it. Again, go on our website, click Request Ministry. Also, one of the things that has truly increased in the last couple months for our team is the need for our tech team. And can we give it up for the wonderful tech team back there? I talked with a few of them last week, and I said, for those of you who watch football, you'll get this reference. I said, you guys are like the offensive linemen. You're so important to the team, yet nobody really notices you unless something goes wrong. And so that's not really a fair place to put them in, but they're so vital to what goes on here. They don't just push buttons and turn on lights and things. They really help set the atmosphere here so that we can go and worship. And so they have done so much to help us stream our services online, to run in-person services, as well as our 10:15 being outside. They've done an incredible job just managing all of the load, but we need some more help. And so if you have experience maybe as a sound engineer, if you have general computer knowledge, or you just have a willingness to learn and help back there, we'd love to have your help. Please don't be intimidated. Don't be worried. Our team is wonderful. They can help teach you anything back there just to help you play a part in us really taking this next step further. If you are looking to do that, you can scan. There's another QR code up here. Get your phone out on the camera, scan the QR code, and it'll open up a link. Or you can go talk to one of our front desk people. We'd love to help you out there. Amen. Awesome. It's time for our offerings. So we can go ahead and prepare that today. Right now, we have four ways that you can give. We encourage you to give digitally. We're trying to remain as contactless as possible. If you'd like to give by check or by cash right here in the service, you could have got an envelope on your way in. One of our ushers will go around right after we're done praying. You can just wave your hand at them with your check or envelope, and they're going to go around and be able to put it in the basket that way. You can also give digitally by going to focalpointchurch.com. Select giving at the top right-hand corner, or you can go through our Focal Point Church app. For those of you watching us online, if you'd like to mail in a check, we have the address right there on the screen that you can mail in a check right there, and we'll be able to receive it that way. I wanted to share a couple things as we prepare our offering. We wanted to share just a praise report that's been going on at our church the last few months. This has been a time that's been very difficult for us as pastors to really get a pulse on what's going on. You know, we're used to being in front of you and being able to kind of see you face to face and hear the stories on the way out, but we've had to do ministry from behind a camera or behind a Zoom call or just through prayer over the last few months. And so it's been difficult and different for us to really know what's going on. But there's two things that we were able to track. We could see our growth group numbers, well, many things, but two things that could really help us. See our growth group numbers, and we've been able to see our giving. And amazingly, we've not just maintained, we've actually increased over the last few weeks, our last few months in both of those categories. Since before all of the COVID and everything, our groups have actually increased on average by 50 to 70 people more per week going online. And our giving has increased in the same 3 month span last year. We've actually had more giving this year than we did last year. I don't know how, but I know all praise belongs to God. Amen. So can we give him praise for a moment for him seeing the blessings, the faithfulness of our church, and the faithfulness of God? And one other thing with that, I wanted to share about our advanced giving and about our construction project. We were actually supposed to close on all of the financing the week that we were supposed to go in quarantine, all of that. And so, understandably so, the bank said, we're going to put things on hold for a while. We're still kind of in limbo for there. But can I tell you, although it was frustrating to see the delay after delay, I saw God's blessing in the midst of it, because the first projections were that we were supposed to open our new facility this March. That's what was we were on track for at the beginning. We were supposed to have the expansion ready to go by March of this year, which we know was when everything started to get a little chaotic. I can't imagine having a new building right now with all the unexpected and all the stuff going on right now. So we've seen God's grace through it. I will tell you, we purposely have not mentioned it. Our advance campaign in the last several weeks, we felt like it would be very insensitive to push for the above and beyond offerings in this time as many people are facing uncertainties. So our advance numbers are down, which we understand, and we understand how that's going to happen. So we thank you, though, if there's many people who have continued to give, who have given faithfully through that. We are counting on that with the bank and all of that. So we appreciate those of you who have been able to give. But our numbers have gone down in that area, even though our numbers overall have gone up over the last few months. We're in limbo. We're trying to find out when the bank's going to say, hey, we can look forward to going forward. And we'll keep you updated with all of that. But we have officially gotten all of our permitting. Everything is done. It's in hand. Just waiting on financing at this point, and then we're good to go. Amen. Come on, somebody praise the Lord today. Let's pray over our offerings, and then the ushers will go around and receive the checks for those of you in here. So Lord, we thank you for every good gift. We praise you for your faithfulness. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. If you have a check, just wave it in the air. Our ushers will come around and get it from you. In the meantime, we have a special presentation from our Acting Up ministry for Father's Day.
She spins and she sways to whatever song plays without a care in the world. And I'm sitting here wearing the weight of the world on my shoulders. It's been a long day and there's still work to do. She's pulling at me saying, Dad, I need you. There's a ball at the castle. I've been invited, and I need to practice my dancing. Oh, please, Daddy, please. So I dance with Cinderella while she's here in my arms. 'Cause I know something the prince never knew. Just glowing and telling us all they had planned. She says, Dad, the wedding's still 6 months away. But I need to practice my dancing. Oh, please, Daddy, please. So I dance with Cinderella while she is here in my arms. I know something the prince never knew. Oh, 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 I dance with Cinderella. I don't want to miss even one song. It's all too soon. The clock will strike midnight. And she
wow, that was awesome. Amen. You know, I raised three boys. I didn't get to do that, but I got two granddaughters, and I get to dance all the time, and it's sweet. Amen. I want to have a prayer before we just begin in the Word, because I feel like we need to be praying daily for our country and our time. And so I really want to model it, and I want you to be take it out of here. And so let's just bow our heads. Father, in the name of Jesus, we know that you are the one that holds nations in your hands, and we cry out to you for our nation. We cry out to you, God, to begin to awaken your church, to awaken your people, that we will know that you are the answer that we need. You are the one that can bring things that we can't even see that are missing. We see the toxicity. We see just all the various things that are in our country. We know that we're not united, and we're praying for the church to unite and be a voice, to be a witness, to be an example in this time. God, we pray that the church will rise up. We will not look to aspects of society, the spheres of society, that we will know that we have a role to play. Father, let us live and be a witness. Let us live and walk with you. You said if we would humble ourselves, that you will hear us, that you will move on our land. So, Father, let us begin to come to you. Let us begin to turn to you. Let us begin to cry to you. Let us begin to come before you and say, God, we come because we know that you can hear and that you can begin to heal and you can begin to restore and you can begin to change things that we can't change. You can open doors we can't open. You can raise up people nationally in the church that can have a voice to the body of Christ, that can speak unto our land. You can raise up people in our community, God. You can begin to unite and build bridges where we've not ever been able to build them. But God, we want to ask you for these things. Lord, move upon this land. We are not going to sit still and be quiet. You said you're looking for someone that will stand before you on behalf of the land. Lord, we will stand before you on behalf of the land. We cry to you for unity. We cry to you for God to awaken the people of God. And we pray for you to begin to move and stretch out your mighty right arm. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. We bless you all, and we come to you in all of our variety of services. You know, we have this service on Friday night, and we're thankful for you that are here. Then Sunday morning, we have one at 8:30, and then we're outside at 10:15. We have about an hour and 10-minute service there so that we can try to keep it short, but minister there. Come in all sweaty, and then we have a 12 o'clock service. So what I do is rotate the 8:30 and the 12 o'clock of being live or then showing this service at times. Everything else is live. The music is live. The ministry is live. The praying is live. The altar is live. But now and then we rotate that service just to give me a little bit of pace so I can pace myself. One of the things that I'm praying for, and one of the things that I know that we need, is open heavens in America today. When Jesus was baptized, in John chapter 1, it says in verse 50 and 51 that when he was baptized, Jesus talked about the heavens opening and the Holy Spirit coming. And then it goes on and describes Jesus when he's meeting Nathanael in verse 50 and 51, and he says this. Nathanael is amazed because he's aware that Jesus is not just an ordinary person, that he is the Son of God. And Jesus says to Nathanael, "You will see greater things than these." And he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending over the Son of Man." Now think about this. Jesus did not say, "Hey, Nathanael, you're going to see blind people receive sight. You're going to receive, watch people with deaf ears hear. You're going to see dead people raised. You're going to see a multitude of people fed, you know, 5,000 with just a few loaves and fish." He didn't say any of those things. He said, what you're going to see is greater than all that. You're going to see the heavens opened and the angels of God ascending and descending. That means taking the resources of heaven and bringing them to the earth. That means you're going to see the spiritual realm impact the physical realm. You're going to see heaven touch earth. And through the Bible, you realize that that's the way God wants to see things. You see that when God was moving, you would see heaven beginning to impact earth. You see in the children of Israel when they're going and there was the plagues, and you see the parting of the sea, and you see the pillar of fire and the cloud leading them from one place to the other place. That was, you're seeing the heavens opened over the children of Israel. When you see Moses going in the tent of meetings and the presence of God coming and meeting with him, and everybody would come outside their tent and watch God meet with Moses, and you're seeing those kinds of things. You see the Ark of the Covenant where they parts the Jordan River, where they come in and the walls of Jericho come down, and every place that they go, they're winning victory after victory. You're seeing open heavens over Joshua and the children. When you see kings humbled themselves and they've got a siege around the city with a military greater than any military that they have, and they know that they're in jeopardy and that they're in a terrible situation, and they humble themselves and they cry out to God, and God says that he's going to come and win a victory they could not win. God's going to open the heavens and come down and do something that they couldn't do on their own. And you realize over and over again in Jesus, when Jesus went around, as he told Nathanael, you're going to see the heavens open. Everywhere he went, you see God moving, God working, God speaking. They see authority they've never known. They see God beginning to do these miraculous things. You see the early church again, what happens? The Holy Spirit comes down, and even though they're persecuted, even though they're scattered around, and even though there's great adversity, there's open heavens over them, and their jail cells are broken open, people are healed, cities are turned upside down, cities that are filled with idolatry are turned upside down and brought into the kingdom of God. And you see, that's what God did. The heavens were opened. You see the presence of God and the kingdom of God moving. But the Bible also talks about closed heavens. It talks about times when the heavens were closed. When it talked about that, God would say things like, there's a covering. And he even used the words, I've shut the heavens. And he would talk about that it would not be easy to connect with God, that it would be dry spiritually. He would talk about turning his face from them. There was a famine of the word of God, that there were no testimonies. Remember in the day of Gideon when he said, where are all the testimonies our ancestors told us about? We don't have any testimonies right now. In the prophet Amos, he said that there was a famine of the word of God. In the days of Samuel, he talked about how the word of God was scarce, that people weren't hearing from God. That's closed heavens. You also see times of spiritual decay, where we talk about unholy altars being built, people turning away from God, people beginning to live in greater and greater sin, that the word of God was growing where they're beginning to fall further and further away from it. And you see decay and darkness. You see the things of God are on the decline, but the things of darkness are in the increase. When you see closed heavens, you usually see that their enemies are advancing. There is disunity, there is war, there is unrest. And one other thing you see when there's closed heaven is there is economic devourers. Whether it was pestilence, drought, or famine, or disease, you see they're sowing much but reaping little. And what am I saying to you? If you look at our time right now, you would not say open heavens. You would say the heavens are closed. And what does God tell us to do if the heavens are closed? And at the same time, God brings shaking after shaking after shaking. God says, 2 Chronicles, listen, verse 13. When I shut up the heavens so that there's no rain, or command locusts to devour the land, or send a plague among my people. It says, when you see that, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves. He didn't say the politicians. He didn't say the media. He didn't say the business elite, the Fortune 500 people. He said, if my people, I say this every week because we're the priest of the land. We are the ones who stand before God on behalf of this time in history. And he says, when you see the heavens shut, when you see these things coming, my people need to humble themselves. I honestly believe that when the pandemic stump came, we started humbling ourselves. But before long, the tone started changing. And then we started politicizing the pandemic, how we're dealing with it. Then all kinds of theories of what's going on. And instead of focusing on God, we start hearing all these things. And then more waves came, more economic waves. And you can realize we begin to fall away. Then unrest comes, and then more unrest comes. And then you begin to realize we're not humbling ourselves anymore. We're not. We're just being tossed about. But humility is the key when you see closed heavens. James chapter 4, verses 6 and verse 10 said, God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Humble yourself before the Lord, and you will be exalted. That applies to a nation, not just an individual. We advance through humility. He tells us over and over again, when you see, if you take the economic things we see, he tells us, pray, seek me, turn to me. He's telling us, humble yourself, turn your heart to me. If you saw the unrest that we see, he would say the same thing. If you saw the pandemic that we've seen, he would say the same thing. If you saw the divisiveness that we see and the toxicity to our civil discourse, he would say the same thing for all four of those things. But all four of them are going on right now. And you know it's not ending anytime soon. We're in a political season. You know all of this stuff. So what's the church supposed to be doing? Humbling ourselves. Realizing we have a role to play in seeing God move in the midst of this. If we just listen to the politicians, we won't humble ourselves. If we just listen to the media, we won't humble ourselves. If we just go with all that's out there and put our hope in that solving us, we won't humble ourselves. But if we get close and quiet and hear God, we hear the breaking of God's heart. We hear that God's saying, when you see these things, cry out to me because I'm trying to change the course of the nation. And we realize the only hope, the only answer we have, the only one going to stop our toxicity is God. God raising up. Now, humility is not natural, but it's vital to seeking God. If you think of any time you had a major change in your life, I guarantee you, you humbled yourself in that season. There's no way. Anytime something dramatically changed or you grew dramatically, humility was involved. Anytime we see a major breakthrough or a great, that we saw the greatest times of growth in our life, it was humility. Anytime you hear a story of revival, God coming down and changing a community, humility was involved in every single case. As Christians, when we see the shakings and we have wave after wave of shaking, we're supposed to recognize that as a time to humble ourselves, to cry out to God, to realize no one else is going to stop all this, solve all this, right this course but God. And so we need to begin to allow the turbulence to stop us, quiet us, humble us, and get us to turn our attention to his word, to his life. That's the reason we are saying we want to come back to first love. We want to put you in the priority position. We realize, God, we don't want anything standing in the way, because if you don't come, we're not secure where things are going. So what exactly does it mean to humble yourself? Because it's not a word that people use and like that much. It's kind of out of fashion. People want to be powerful, overcoming, strong, in control. Humility sounds weak or vulnerable or even undesirable. Sometimes you think of humility as sounding as though you do not see yourself with very much esteem. It's kind of like you see yourself as nothing and that you're insignificant or you don't think well or you're a doormat to other people or you're a weak person. But that is not biblical humility or godly humility. Humility, and I'm going to just mention four things about it. Humility is the opposite of pride. Humility is the awareness of the supremacy of God. Humility is aware that our greatest need is God. That's the reason when shakings come, God's giving us an opportunity to humble ourselves, because it's real easy to fall into a false pride to think, I can handle my life. I can sort my problems. I can handle all this stuff. But when everything starts to shake, you realize I don't have control of the economy. I can't just manage everything in life, and it begins to cause you to be aware the only one that does is God. Because sometimes we can get false hope in ourselves, in our times in which we live, and when things shake, it's supposed to remind us and bring us out of that pride or that arrogance and turn us back and to realize our only real security is God. And humility comes to be aware that what we need right now, because I think a lot of us have politicized our Christianity. It's like we mix, whether you're a Democrat or Republican, because I've seen both, you mix it like they're one and the same. They're not one and the same. And you begin to separate them and realize, I need God. I don't need that. I need God. We need God to come back, because the toxicity in our country is tearing us apart. And if I stay in the midst of all of that, all I'm going to do is be a part of the problem. And I'm not going to become humble, because I'm still hoping that this party can save us or that party can save us. And I'm telling you, friends, we've passed that point. We need God. We need God to move on this land desperately. When you become humble, you see the futility of your self-reliance and your self-trust. You realize that apart from Him, you can't do it. Many of us got humbled because we fell into a sin we never thought we'd fall into, or something fell apart in our life that we never thought would fall apart, and it did, and it began to humble us. And what happens? You begin to depend on God, listen to God, everything He says you do. When you get humble like that, you start taking off. And you start realizing He's my source of power. It's not me. He's my source of righteousness and goodness. It's not me. Because I can fall away. We need to realize we can't navigate all these challenges we're facing. And there's no person out there that can. We need to be crying out. I believe God can raise up some key figures. It may be even 3 years from now before we see them come up. But I'm telling you, as we're crying out now, God's working. God's working. God's working on people. And I honestly believe you and I are supposed to be a part of that. We need to begin to realize that God's value begins to rise up. And all these things that we've been standing on, we realize they're shaky ground. Humility is submission to God's will. Pride is self-will. It's like we're not even asking God what He says or what He does. Humility knows that God's will is perfect, right, and good, and that His wisdom is higher, and we want to obey Him. We know that blessing, covering, protection is found in walking in God's wisdom and God's will. But many times when you begin to lose humility, you begin to decrease obedience. The reason I spoke so many times on obedience is because the only way we really begin to humble ourselves is to come back to walking in God's will. Walking in what God spoke over our life. Many times when you begin to lose humility, you begin to just drift and just drift and just drift. And before long, you realize there's many things God spoke to your life, you're not doing them anymore. When we live in pride, we just live in self-will. That's the reason Jesus says, why do you call me Lord and not do what I tell you? Pride is you do what's right in your own eyes. You argue with the Bible. You tell us why you can't live the Bible in this day and time. You're acting as though your wisdom is greater than God's wisdom. Your understanding is greater than God's understanding, and it's not. Real humility comes when we start saying, I want your will. That's the reason God says, when you see all these shakings, if my people will humble themselves, if they'll start coming out and saying, Jesus Christ, we want to do it your way, because our way has led us to this terrible place that we're in right now, and it's not working, and we're scared of what we're going to be leaving to our children and grandchildren. So before I leave this place, I'm going to seek you, humble myself, cry out to you, because we need open heavens over this place. Third, humility is walking in dependency on God. Pride is being filled with your own opinion and views. 1 Corinthians 13:12 said, all that I know now is partial and incomplete. But then, talking about when I will see him, I will know everything completely, just as God knows me completely. When I first started humbling myself after 9/11 and started all that seeking, God spoke something to me, and it was embarrassing, it was humiliating, but he showed me that I was full of my own thoughts. And he was showing me, what you see is just a part. You're so full of your own thoughts that you're not even seeking my thoughts. You're not even seeking my way. You're trying to do everything out of your wisdom, your perspective, and you're leaning on that, drawing on that, walking in that. And I want to tell you, I honestly believe there's so much pride of opinion in America. And what most of us are, feel like we're almost... One time the Hebrews, it says they were stuffing their mouths so full of the manna, they were choking on it. I feel like we're choking on all of our opinions. And we're full of all of our opinions, this view, that view, and nobody's humbling themselves and saying, God, we need to hear from heaven. And it's like, what we see is just a piece. When you're humble, you realize, I need to hear from God. I'm just a part of the body. I don't hear everything. I don't know everything. And you start getting humble to realize I need to walk with him and depend upon him. I can't just go off in my own views and think that's going to get me where I need to go. Humility is a vow. Also, number four, humility is to treat people with worth. Pride is selfish and arrogant, and it treats people as though they're less than us. God has placed value in every single human being. Everyone was made in his image. But those that are born again, he said that he's reconciled them to himself. He adopted them into his family. He made them a joint heir with Jesus. Think of that. And he placed his life within them. And he's telling us that we should not do anything to create disunity in his family, in his body. I love what he said in Philippians. He said, Chapter 2, verse 3 and 4, do nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit. Think about that if we as a church did that. Nothing out of selfish ambition or conceit. But in humility, counting others more significant than ourselves. Let each of us look not only to his own interest, but also to the interest of others. Nowadays, when you see a sweet moment, it strikes you because there's so few sweet moments. Seeing the little play with the dads dancing with the daughters touches your heart because it's a sweet moment. Now what we see so much is so few sweet moments. And the body of Christ is supposed to radiate his love. We're supposed to walk in humility. But if we do not get intentional about seeking God, we will walk more in the spirit that's in the land than in the Holy Spirit. We're going to walk in the divisiveness. We're going to walk in the that angst that's there. We're going to carry that. And he said, you're supposed to walk in humility. I honestly believe a cry should come in our hearts. God, clean my heart in the way I treat and live with people, because I'm not walking your way. I'm walking the world's way. The church needs to humble itself before God if we want to see real change. One of the things when I was looking at this and thinking about talking about humility, because I know I really feel like there's just a spiritual wave that's trying to take the church out of humility and out of that seeking of God. And I was saying, God, what do I need to do to humble my heart? I've been praying this whole time since this pandemic. I live a lifestyle of seeking you. What do I need to do? And one of the things God began to turn in my heart and show in my heart, that there's still not that desperate cry. I feel like that cry is forming. I feel like that cry is beginning to come. I mean, there was a little bit of a cry during the pandemic. There's a little bit of a cry during the economic crisis. There's a little bit of a cry when you start seeing the unrest. There's a little bit of cry when you started seeing the division that was in our country, and how is that going to be healed? How are we going to restore? There's these things, but you realize, is there a part of me that is still sitting back passive? Is there a part of me that is not beginning to really say, God, without you, I don't know where we're going to be? And I realized that I started just praying into this. That's the reason I said at the beginning, I want to pray daily, and I want us to pray daily. And I started praying, God, I don't know how to awaken your people, that we leave the slumber that we've been in, that we leave the just watching and waiting on other people, the passivity. I don't know how to heal the wound that's in the land. I don't know how to unite the church. I don't know how to push back the darkness that's flooding our society. I don't know how to move upon the hearts, but I know without you coming that we are not going to do well. I know this is going to begin to consume and hinder the work that we're seeing here. And God, we desperately need to see a move of God. And I just begin to cry out more and saying, God, we need you. And the more I cried, the more I began to let a prayer come out of my heart, the more you could feel the self-reliance, the trying, just being passive about it all, the just being doing my own thing, you begin to feel it falling off of you. And you begin to feel an urgency for God. You begin to feel a desperation. We need God. You begin to feel something rise up in you. Whatever it takes, God, whatever you want to do, you're not focused on all the noise out there. You're just wanting his heart. You're just wanting his heart. What do you want to do here? Because I want to see it done. And you're beginning to let yourself say, God, whatever you're asking of me to play in this, what you want to do, I want to play that role. And you realize, friends, there needs to be this daily kind of praying this way. We can't just sit back and watch it. This is so bad. What are we going to do? That slumber. We're not powerless. We live and worship a risen Savior. We're not powerless. We have the throne of God who holds nations in his hands. We have story after story in this book. When just a few people begin to really seek him, how that could begin to turn a whole country. The core sin in the Garden of Eden was turning away from God, rejecting God, and saying, we don't need you. We don't need your wisdom or your way. We'll do it our way. It was declaring independence from God. That's pride. The core of turning back to God is humility, declaring we can't do it without you. We need every word you speak to us, and we want to follow out everything you've given us. And with all the shakings that we've had, it has allowed the pride to be shaken in our lives. It's allowed the pride to begin to be uprooted. It's allowed the pride to be exposed. It's allowed the false hope. It's allowed the deception that we had everything in control. It allowed all of those things to begin to rise up so that we can begin to develop a cry of real humility to God. Jesus lived in humility. Jesus walked in humility with God. He realized that he could do nothing on his own. He was dependent upon the Father for everything. He prayed, that was written about him in Philippians 2, verses 5 through 9. He emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God highly exalted him and bestowed upon him the name that is above every name. It says that Jesus said of himself in John 5:19, truly, truly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of his own accord, but only what he sees the Father doing. For whatever the Father does, the Son does likewise. In verse 30 of that same chapter, he said, I can do nothing on my own. I seek not my own will, but the will of him who sent me. Jesus saying, I don't live independent of God. I only speak his words. I only do his actions. I only follow out his instructions. Chapter 14, verse 24 of John, he said, whoever does not love me does not keep my words. And the one who hears And the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father who sent me. These words reveal Jesus' root, why his life was so powerful. I only do what the Father tells me. I only speak what the Father tells me. I go. Remember when they wanted to just make him like the big deal in a town? They said, oh, you stay here. You be with us. The whole town is out celebrating. He said, no, I must be about my Father's work. I must. That is what I'm here for. My prayer is that more and more of us are going to be having that cross. I've got to be about his work. Because remember, you didn't choose him. He chose you and appointed you to bear much fruit. He assigned to you. And it says in Acts 17, he put you in the exact times and place that you should live. He put us in this time. He chose you. And he's saying, I'm shaking everything. And my people, you understand what this means. I'm shaking everything so you'll humble yourself. You'll come out of the slumber. You will begin to turn your hearts back to me. You'll begin to have a cry for me to come and to move. There's so many shakings that we need to humble ourselves. We cannot listen to all these other voices. It deadens the cry that needs to rise up in our hearts. We need to let him revive us. I am praying and crying out to see men and women rising all across this country and world to rise up in authority, to want to say, God, I'm here to do your will. Whatever you ask of me, I want to do it. And there's such a different spirit between a self-reliant spirit and a dependency on God, between a human effort and a walking by faith. There's such a different heart between pride and humility, between cry of we need God and then let's run this program the way everybody else is doing it. And you realize that God, that nothing that is just running out of human effort is working anymore. Nothing that is just following a program that so-and-so did. He's calling us to be dependent. He's calling us to seek him. And if we seek him, I feel like every week I want to kind of coast a little bit and just preach something. He's telling me, it's not going to work. I feel confounded in my mind. I feel frustrated. And I have to humble myself and say, God, what do you want to say? And that's you. It's not just me. That's what he's wanting to do here. I've shared this several times, but I love it. And I feel it gets at the spirit of humility. It was something shared at Campus Crusade many, many years ago, maybe 15 years ago. And it caused people to begin to humble themselves. And I just have an abbreviated version. But it was the difference between proud people and humble people. It said proud people focus on the failures of others. Humble people are overwhelmed with their own spiritual need. Proud people are self-righteous, critical, fault-finding. Humble people are compassionate, have a forgiving spirit. Proud people rely on self. They're self-sufficient. They have trouble trusting God. Humble people are spiritually dependent. They see their lack, and they seek to stay close to God. Proud people want to maintain control and keep their way. Humble people surrender control and yield their will. Proud people want to prove that they're right. Humble people are willing to lay down their rights. Proud people have a demanding spirit. Humble people have a giving heart. Proud people are self-protective of their time, their things, themselves. Humble people deny self and serve. Proud people desire success and accolades. Humble people want to please God. Proud people are driven by recognition and applause. Humble people are thrilled to serve the Lord and share credit. Proud people are wounded when they're not promoted. Humble people rejoice when others are lifted up. Proud people feel confident in how much they know. Humble people know how much they have to learn. Proud people want God so that they can be used, so they can be happier, so they can be successful. Humble people want God because he's worthy of their whole heart. Proud people keep others at arm's length. Humble people take the risk of being hurt. Proud people are quick to blame and defend. Humble people can see when they're wrong and accept it. Proud people want to maintain an image. Humble people don't try to pretend. Proud people are concerned with the consequences of sin. Humble people are grieved over the root of sin. Proud people compare to others and think they're not that bad. Humble people compare to his word and they bow down. Proud people are concerned with their wants and themselves. Humble people long for God's will. Proud people don't read the Bible much. Humble people tremble at his word. Proud people don't ache for the needs of others. Humble people cry out in prayer, and they feel God's heart for others. There's such a difference between a humble heart and a proud heart. A self-reliant heart is what God has been shaking. A proud heart is what God is trying to uproot in us. Humility is letting Christ take over and have control. Humility is softening, yielding, trusting, depending, resting in Christ, that He's my Redeemer, my Savior, my God, my King. He's the hope of heaven. It says in Psalms 25:9, He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble His way. You know, there's a lot of things that people are going to do to try to fix a lot of things, but it's the humble people who are going to hear the Lord's word and be able to walk something, because what we do in the Lord will last. It says in Luke chapter 14, verse 11, for those who exalt themselves will be humbled, but those who humble themselves will be exalted. It says in Matthew 18 that unless you change and become like a child, unless you humble yourself, you'll not enter the kingdom of heaven. Humility is what God is asking for. And I'm asking us, I'm asking for three things, and I want to be real specific. I have not written them down here, so if you would jot them down. But I thought about, what does it really mean? How do we humble ourselves? How can we arise as His church and not get duped into biting bait and running and chasing our tails? How can we let all these shakings bring what God wants them to bring? Humility. How can the humility deepen? So the first thing I wrote is we've got to establish an open heavens over our life and our home and this place. We need an open heavens. We need God to come. To do that means that we realize we need Him. We seek Him. We read the Bible. We pray. I've talked about it ad infinitum here. It's obviously the most talked about thing I do. We need to read the Bible, pray, and worship, and seek the presence of God. We need to do that individually. We need to do that as a family. We need to do that together. We have prayer. Even if you don't come, you can watch it. Go to our Facebook page and tap into prayer. If we're not intentional about praying and opening the heavens, then the spirit of the land will control us and hinder us. I'm telling you, you're not greater than spiritual forces. They will hinder you. And we need to say, God, the greatest way I can show my humility is by giving you the first part of my day and seek you as the priority of my life. The second thing is we've got to cut out the noise. We need to reduce the noise that's pulling our eyes, our attention. You know what's pulling you away. You know what's consuming you, numbing you, or causing outrage, inciting you. That's the word I was looking for. It's inciting your flesh. It's inciting things inside of you. It's not drawing you into greater dependency upon God. It's igniting the flesh inside of you. That's not where you're going to find the God answers. And we need to begin to cut those things out. You're not going to miss anything. Because what we need to hear is the voice of God. There's plenty of people out there in the media, the politicians, the activists, to begin to do what they're doing. I'm not against. They have a role to play. But I know that I have a role to play because I was chosen by God. I was adopted into His family. I was brought into this time in history. He chose me and appointed me to bear fruit. And when everything shakes, He's told me what the church is supposed to do. We're supposed to humble ourselves and seek Him. And if that's enticing me away, I need to shut it out so that I can hear His voice. I remember one time a man was praying about something and praying about something, and his wife kept talking and talking and talking to him. And he said, I can't hear you and God at the same time. Would you please stop talking to me about this? And she did. Some of us realize, I can't hear God and all this noise at the same time. I need to hear His voice. Third, be intentional with walking out what He shows you, whether it seems little or whether it seems big. Walk out the little things. When He tells you to let go of something, let go of it. You may think, I don't see how this is going to infect our nation. I'm telling you, you don't know God. God's ways aren't your ways. His thoughts aren't your thoughts. What he will do is begin to align things that will begin to impact people. Maybe the sphere that you're going to impact is so big, and he wants to do something in you to begin to bring healing in your family. I'm telling you, there's going to be rays of light. They're going to shine in and around your life if you begin to walk out what he shows you. And there's a revelation that you will have that will ignite a revelation in me. And I'm telling you, it'll be like dominoes of what happens. And we need to be intentional to walk out what he's saying. I'm praying. I remember one time we were praying. We were praying to want to be used of God. And we were praying. We knew God had been working in our lives to send us somewhere where we had nowhere to go. And we just kept praying. And then God began to open up. And I went into England. And God opened another place and another place and another place. And he just started opening those places. And you realize God's going to open a door that only he can open. God's going to begin to do something that only he can do. And we need to be faithful with what he gives us. Because whoever's faithful with a little gets what? More. Open the heavens. Let the heavens open over you. Pray, worship, seek his presence until you begin to feel like heaven's beginning to come. The ability to touch God, connect with God is easier, more powerful, more tangible. The heavens are open. When you feel like we're not getting anywhere, God, then ask him, God, what's grieving your presence from coming into our house over my life? And God can show you, this is grieving me. Deal with this, and you'll see the heavens begin to open. Let's cut out the noise. Let's begin to set our hearts towards the Lord, and let's begin to walk out exactly what he's saying. And I believe God can begin to use us for whatever level. Heaven determines how big it is, but I want to be faithful with what we're given to do. Let's rise up to our feet. No more. I don't want to stay running a cycle. I don't want to stay and go back into a numbness. I don't want to go back into a being confounded or being just upset by everything that's happening day after day. I want to begin to connect to you and follow what you're showing and saying. I want to be a part of your solution. God, we're asking you, unite us under the banner of Jesus Christ. Let us begin to become serious about reading, praying, seeking. There's plenty of people in this church that can encourage us and strengthen us in that. But let us become serious about seeking you. God, let us begin to cut out the noise. Sometimes it's just numbing ourselves all the time, binge watching all the time. But God, let us begin to hear your heart and let us walk it out. I'm asking you, God, there's people in here that have never seen themselves as one that could make a difference in the world. But you often took the Davids that were shepherds and brought down the Goliaths with people like that. So God, do something. As people just begin to humble themselves in reality, humble ourselves to seek you, to focus on you, and to walk out what you say. God, I pray you begin to bring a church to humility that you may speak and move in a mighty way. We just bless you. We praise you. Just take a moment here. Just take a moment.
And I surrender all to you. Surrender.
Father, you did a lot of miracles to put a church here. So many that it's amazing, one after another, to put a church here. You did a lot of things to reach the people that this message is reaching. And you did all of this, God, for a purpose. And there is a time in history where we need light, where we need a people to hear your word. And we see it all shaking, and that we begin to truly humble ourselves. Father, we pray right now in Jesus' name that you will begin to rise up your people, your remnant, your ones that have ears and eyes. And God, let us not put off, procrastinate anymore to act upon what you're doing. Father, I pray, awaken your people. Help them to rise in the name of Jesus. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.